Tube bending is not very hard. I'm going to prove it to you by showing you an easy to follow 3-step process in 7 minutes or less, starting now. Anyone bending tube knows that mistakes in metal can be expensive. If you have bent tube before, let us know in the comments below because we're curious. I told you there are 3 steps in this process. Those steps are design, layout, and bending. We're going to cover them in order. In design, my favorite way to do it is in software, but you can also do it by hand. The way to do that is cut out a couple bends, like a 30 and a 60 and a 90, and you're going to use those by putting them in the corners or around the outside of whatever it is you're designing the tubing to fit. Measure between those bends using a tape measure. You can measure the exact angle of those bends using a protractor. This happens to be a digital one. You can of course use an analog one as well. And then if you have rotation between those bends, like say you have two 90s and they are not coplanar, you're going to measure the angle between them using an angle cube or some other device to measure angles. We have links to where you can get all these tools in the description of the video below. You can also design in software, such as Bentec. Bentec is cool. It has features like built-in clamp lock offsets for most machines and ways to compensate for spring back in the software. But you don't have to have that to be successful because we're going to show you before the end of the video how to do those two things by hand. Doing accurate tube layouts is quick and easy. All we have to do is take the numbers from our design, and we're going to measure from center line or end, whichever way we did our design. And we're going to label where each bend starts, like this, B1, and then where the clamp goes, like C1. The other thing that we're going to do is we are going to put arrows that point from the clamp to where the bend starts. This helps make sure that when we load the tubing in the machine, we can still see these arrows and the bend is behind the clamp block. If we don't do that and we do it backwards, what we're going to end up with is a bend that's in the wrong spot by about a foot, guaranteed to be in the scrap bin after that. The other thing these arrows can do is if we have rotation between our bends, we're going to still have the arrow facing up right where we put, let's say, clamp 2 in this case. So if we use our rotation gauge on, of course, the tubing while it's in the machine, and we rotate that exact correct amount, and we make sure that it's just right, but we do it in the wrong direction and we cannot see our arrow for C2, this is also going in the scrap bin, and that's a huge waste of money. So those arrows are a good coarse way to tell, did I rotate in the correct direction? And then you can just read the cube to tell exactly how many degrees down to the fifth of a degree if you've rotated the right amount. Those are the two best ways to keep your material from ending up being expensive learning experiences. So we have our tubing loaded in the machine. We put our angle indicator on so we can tell our rotation between bends. We are going to make the first bend. So clamp block goes on right on C1. This is going to be a 30 degree bend. So first thing we do is we zero our degree indicator so we know our rotation is correct. We're going to bend to 30 degrees. That's exactly 30. And we take the spring out of the tube, advance just until it's tight, which is right now. And we are 3 degrees under 30. So we've got to overbend by 3 to get an actual 30. So there's 33 degrees. Now, I could take this clamp block off, but there's a benefit to leaving it on. And I will show that to you. We can take a second clamp block and install it on the tubing. And when we put our clamp block in place for bend number 2 with exactly 30 degrees of rotation between the bends, I'm going to do a 45 degree bend. Same process again for spring back. I'm seeing 4 degrees of spring back this time, so 49. There is 49 degrees. Now the cool thing about this we have both bend locations perfectly preserved on this tube, which is of course a three-dimensional piece. And we can resume either one of these bends by simply putting the pin back through the same clamp block and bending more for bend one, or doing the exact same thing for bend two. This is a really cool feature on this tubing bender that allows you to do that. One cool thing you can do in the Model 600 is S-bends. It's one of the tricks I'm gonna show you at the end of this video. This clamp block made the bend my hand is on. This one's gonna make a bend right past it. This clamp block's actually upside down compared to the usual orientation in the machine, and that's not a problem. We're gonna still use the same 4.5 CLR clamp block location, this time with the clamp block inverted. The bend's gonna bend to about 80 degrees. And the result is two bends that are touching. No gap in between them whatsoever. So there is our three-dimensional piece with an S-bend in it. And you can do much more complex bending than this with this machine. And you can also bend back the other way again, in case I must ask you a question. If you want to see more cool hacks, S-bends, tricks and tips, subscribe to this channel. This is our first of many technical videos helping you bend tube accurately and reduce scrap. Also, check the box next to the bell. That's going to enable us to notify you when that video actually goes live. Thank you so much. We will see you next time.